my monster from his slab began to rise, and suddenly, to my surprise,
he did the mash.
He did the monster mash.
The monster mash.
It was a graveyard smash.
He did the mash.
It caught on in a flash.
He did the mash.
He did the monster mash.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Hero Movie Podcast, your greatest source for superhero movie and TV discussion in the multiverse. I'm your host, Adam Portress, and I'm joined by Sweet Sean Kovacs from the internet.
Did anyone leave a weird green light on in this room?
And of course, Bruce Leslie is out this week, everybody. Do not worry. He is not sick. He is not impaired. He is with wife. It is his wife's birthday, so we decided best to keep Bruce in the good column. So we let him go, but do not worry. We've got all of those fine things covered. But you know what? Ain't nothing that me and old Sweet Shonza can't handle for ourselves. No, sir.
Especially when we're talking about Mr. Boogedy.
Oh, my word, everybody. Mr. Boogedy this week, I don't know. We talked about this off air, for people that don't know, you can get this if you go over to patreon.com/HMP, get pre-show, post-show. In the post-show, we were deciding on what we watched. I think I'm the one who came up with it, but I can't believe how quickly Bruce okayed it, even though I'm not even 100% sure how this has a comic book connection, but we've got one, so.
Well, that's good. I didn't know how he would have come up with it either, but I also shed no tears for the man because we have done so many manga and like Japanese inspired things during COVID.
Yeah.
That I had to do some twisty turny stuff too in order to make it work. So,
but hopefully it will be. It'll be well worth everyone's trouble here. And apparently the internet's a buzz. No.
Yeah, there's a couple of people who reached out and were like, I am so excited that you guys are going to talk about this. And as I said to you off air, you know, this is one of those things which makes me glad that we have our dumb show. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, anybody can talk about Karate Kid and everyone has talked about Karate Kid. But when it comes to stuff like Nightman or Mr. Boogedy, like the stuff that's like super weird and oddball-y, like that's the stuff that I like the most. I think that that's our best stuff.
And we are in the world of Bizarre this week from 1986.
Boy, are we.
Mr. Boogedy. And it's available right now if you're on Disney Plus. It's available right there with its sequel, Bride of Boogedy, which maybe one day we'll get to. That one's a feature length one. That's a proper feature length. That's an hour and a half.
Oh,
that
wow,
one.
Really? So they really went for the gusto on that sequel.
Yeah,
kind of like Bride of Frankenstein.
Yeah, exactly. They're like, you know how awesome that first one did? What if we put that and dialed it to 11, boy? And apparently they did that. I feel like I remember seeing that one as well, but we'll kind of get into my history with all of this as we go on.
Please, because I really want to know about your history with this stuff.
It's a lot of, well, it's something. But first, we do got to say big thank you to everyone who helped support us over at patreon.com/HMP. As I said previously, you get the pre-show, post-show, and of course, the magnificent, the all-knowing, all-powerful Dinger Zone. Ooh, we got so much good stuff. Every single week there. And we thank you for supporting us, even if, you know, from the $1 all the way on up to the big icon producer levels that people are at here. Whatever you feel that you got out of this show, throw it back to us and you get extra content in the meantime. You can't much beat that. But if you can't, you want to do what everybody else does, man. They go over to the iTunes there and drop us a 5-star review, a.k.a. Humdinger.
Humdinger.
And this one comes to us from the Reverend Bob. It's entitled, you're going to love this, Son of a Teamster, from the Son of a Teamster, from the Reverend Bob. And it reads as follows. This is an amazing podcast that I look forward to every week. Family friendly, always engaging, and a great team that complements each other. You have a wealth of knowledge, someone who's worked in the business, the glue that holds it all together. The comic book knowledge is amazing, as is your comic timing. The reference pulls are deep. The Stallone connection is fantastic. My dad would have loved Sean's view on Teamsters. Please give a shout-out to Dr. Dan Dew. It's been a while since he's stopped by. That's from the Reverend Bob, 5 stars, a.k.a. Humdinger.
Dang it. We don't talk about the Dr. Dan Do anymore, do we? Because that one guy's name was actually Dr. Dan Do, and he was like, what are you guys doing?
That was the best. Honestly, that's one of the crowning moments in this show's history is that we just, like, some dude gives us a bad review on iTunes. His name's Dr. Dan Do. We give him absolute crap for, like, 3 months, 6 months, whatever it was. And then somebody just goes, hey, Dan, you're a doctor, aren't you? Well, there's this podcast that's kind of making fun of you. You want to take a listen? And he did, and then emailed us back and saying, listen, I know it's not me, but I am Dr. Dan Dew. And we're just like, this is out of this world, man.
It was so crazy, man. We even made him like his own character, and I'm sure he never listened again. But man, if he would have gotten on the right episode, oh, he would have been so mad.
Yeah, and that was half our thing at that point, where it was just like, he gave us a bad review. We talked him up from a 3-star review to a 4-star review, and then we kept talking. And then it went from a 4-star to a 2-star.
The first place, he was very upset that we didn't like some show. I can't remember what the name
Agents
of the
show S.H.I.E.L.D.,
was.
I think.
Oh, right, it was. It was Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. He loved Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. And we were not fans of it at the time. And I turned around on that show later. I thought that they were doing a pretty good job, even though it's still kind of ridiculous. But we got, because you and I are cut from the same cloth of, oh, this person doesn't like what we're doing. Let's really start sticking that needle in deeper and deeper and deeper.
Yep, well, that does sum us up quite well. It's like, oh, you don't like that? Well, let me tell you something.
Yes, which explains our personal life a lot.
It does. Just because, oh, all of these things seem to add up, don't they? I suppose so.
You're going to die alone and afraid.
But at least you'll be afraid. That's something.
Yeah, at least you're not dead inside.
You won't be hopeless. Then you'll just be afraid. It's at least you can grab onto that as you flee. Okay, all right. We're going into a weird way. Yeah. So let's get into. Oh, so patreon.com/HMP is pretty much what I'm trying to say, everybody. And thank you for all the reviews and all that kind of good stuff. Bruce is not here, but we still got one.
It's time for Bruce's Comic Book Connection.
Well, Bruce is out this week, but we've got a comic book connection pre-recorded, so take a listen.
Mr. Boogedy is a motion picture of such life-changing magnitude that one can be forgiven for not realizing that there were stories that existed before Mr. Boogedy, or as some scholars say, BB, meaning, of course, before Boogedy. A quick internet search revealed that there were, in fact, over 100 stories in the BB era. So the challenging question is, were any of them significant? I thought that maybe Boogedy had the evil Puritan market cornered at the very least, but scholars debate whether or not that is, in fact, the case. In an attempt to answer the question, I did a cursory Google search for the term evil pilgrim. And unfortunately, it turns out so many actual historical pilgrims perpetrated real historical atrocities that any fictional ones got buried in the search results. So maybe, just maybe, Mr. Boogedy is in truth nonfiction, posing as a Disney story of the week. I mean, there's no way to prove that isn't the case, right, guys? I also found Scott Pilgrim's evil exes listed as a possible result, but we've already covered that twice. So, no thanks to Google, and fully due to the mosaic of odd things I just happen to be familiar with, I did happen to know of a fictional Puritan who dips his toe quite frequently into the world of the supernatural, and has also graced the pages of what the French call les books du comique. Everyone here is familiar with Conan the Barbarian, and by extension the character's creator, Robert E. Howard. But you may be surprised to find out that Conan wasn't Howard's first bone-crushing, bloodthirsty monster slayer, because before Conan, Howard's adventure tales were built around a 17th-century Puritan, an honest-to-goodness black-top hat with a belt buckle on the front-wearing Puritan named Solomon Kane. Kane is tall and gloomy and has pale skin, Does that sound a little bit like a pre-boogedified Mr. Boogedy? I know I certainly think so. Solomon Kane didn't have a magical cloak that preserved him as an evil apparition, but he did have flintlock pistols, kind of an atypical item for a Puritan to be walking around with. He also had a juju staff that was given to him by a genuine African shaman. It turns out that what Solomon was given was the staff of Solomon, and I gotta point out right now just what a coincidence that was. That staff of Solomon was older than even the earth itself, and had all kinds of spooky implications. Marvel Comics published several comics featuring Solomon Kane in the 70s and 80s, and it's my understanding that they were modestly successful, and were published mainly in an attempt to capitalize on the popularity of Conan comics at the time. But despite being created by the same person, folks who buy barbarian comics and folks who buy comics about late 16th, early 17th century Puritans aren't necessarily the exact same people. After Marvel's rights to the property lapsed, Dark Horse Comics started printing Solomon Kane comics, much to the love and admiration of the throngs of Solomon Kane diehards around the globe, a group I endearingly know as Solomon Canaanites. You can imagine how these SKWs shouted out with glee when in the 80s, Disney gave us not one, but two made-for-TV movies about Mr. Boogedy, a character that had almost, but not entirely, no connection to Solomon Kane. But sadly, as with all the fiercest flames, it burned brightly but quickly as the sort of supernatural pilgrim genre went dark after Bride of Boogedy failed to find the appreciation in its own time that it so richly deserved. But the flame was kindled anew at Comic-Con 2006 when an announcement was made that would forever change the course of human history. That was when it was announced that Solomon Kane, a feature film based upon the eponymous character, was in development at Davis Films with Michael J. Bassett writing and directing. How could that production possibly go wrong with a writer and director who would eventually go on to direct one episode of Netflix's beloved Iron Fist series? The film would eventually be released in 2009. And by the way, guys, we need to get that on our schedule for Thanksgiving so I can recycle this bit in 3 weeks and see if anybody notices. 2009, Solomon Kane starred none other than the man who bailed on V for Vendetta after 6 weeks, James the Puritan Purefoy. The movie was clearly intended to be the first in a trilogy, but because of reasons that I assume are almost certainly attributable to the current global pandemic, the sequels have not yet been produced. The action-packed movie of pure Puritan adventure was probably great. I don't actually know. I haven't seen it yet because, of course, I'm waiting until the trilogy is complete so I can marathon it. I do know the film was featured at 2009's San Diego Comic-Con, probably to universal praise. I think that's the year everyone dressed like pilgrims for Comic-Con. I know the Canaanites came out on force because the movie made $19 million at the box office against a budget of a paltry $40 million. So there you have it, folks. Perhaps, just perhaps, one of the most tenuous comic book connections ever made for the Disney movie of the week, Mr. Boogedy.
I tell you what, all it has to be is tenuous, right?
Yeah. It has to work and it has to smell right, but that's about it.
Does it come from an honest place?
No, nothing we do is honest.
That's true.
Yeah, and you know, we're hucksters.
We're podcasters, so that tells you all you need to know right there. So this is Mr. Boogedy. It came out April 20th, 1986 as a part of the Magical World of Disney. Here's the IMDb plot line for those of you who've never heard of this gem. I'd play you a trailer, but as you might imagine, 1986 Disney television, not a lot of TV trailers out there for it. And even though you can go and, like, you know, rent it on like YouTube or whatever, and you go, trailer, it's just a scene, and I hate that. Come on now. Here's the IMDb plotline. A novelty salesman moves his family into a new house. Initially dismissing the incidents as more of their father's practical jokes, the family soon learns that the house is haunted by people who lived in the house 300 years precisely. Previously. I'm like, that last word doesn't make sense. That's because you read it wrong, dummy.
That was a really succinct like plot synopsis.
It kind of is for a movie that's like, it's very strange. It's 45 minutes long. So, you know, even if you're in the busiest of hurries, I think you could probably squeeze Mr. Boogedy in during your Halloween holiday celebration. No?
You can, because I did it this morning because I have no time, as you know. My time is not my own anymore. And so this morning when I saw what the runtime of this thing was, I said, oh, sweet Christmas, that's great.
I feel like I've won a prize already.
For more than one reason, because first of all, I know that they're not, you know, like padding it. Mm-hmm. If it's an hour and a half long movie, the fact that it's just 45 minutes, it's like, you know, you're getting your prime cuts with that.
Yeah.
And so both things, I was like, yes, it's not going to take up all of my morning and it's not going to be padded. So awesome. I got to ask you this question because this is the thing that I've been thinking about when it comes to Mr. Boogedy with you. How did you come across this?
So I came across this, I'm going to say probably around in the neighborhood. I couldn't tell you an exact date, but I'm going to say in the neighborhoods between 1988 and 1990.
Oh, wow.
Somewhere in there. So I'm, you know, 5 to 6, 7 years old, somewhere right around then.
So is it a VHS that you're getting or is it on Disney somewhere?
Oh, it's better than that. My brother and my sister and myself went to a daycare because my parents both worked. My dad was in retail. My mom was in whatever she was doing. I think she was like lawyer stuff at that point. Not, she wasn't one. She was working for one. We weren't that kind of family.
You don't need to explain. The lady was working.
She was working. Both parents are working. So we got sent off to the daycare after school and everything. And, of course, you know, most of the time you're playing outside and doing all the things that kids love to do. But, of course, on some days it's raining. And, of course, you know, you got to bring those kids inside and you got to entertain them some way. And a lot of the kids at this school, like, they loved horror movies of all types and stuff. Huh. And I was not one of those. There were even times where maybe like the power was out or something. I forget what it was, but like they would sit around and like tell like ghost stories and stuff, and that would scare the bejesus out of me. I'll tell you, because I was a frightened little child all the time. I scared quite easily. But one of the things that they would do is put on this Mr. Boogedy that I feel was on either, I don't think somebody taped it off a Disney Channel, because the small town that I came from, I don't think got Disney Channel to like probably early 90s-ish kind of thing. So it was taped somewhere and put out for us. And I think it was this one and Bride of Boogedy, because when you put two of those together, that's 2 hours worth of just sitting kids in front of a TV and have them, you know, sure, kind of zone out.
Sure.
Which, as you might imagine, would be a great plan for a daycare. Just watch this crap, kids. And I just remember this thing just scaring the crap out of me when I was a little kid. I was just...
And how old are you, like, roughly?
5, 6, 7, somewhere in that neighborhood.
Sure. I can imagine being 5, 6, or 7 and being scared absolutely crapless from Mr. Boogedy.
Yes. And we've talked about it, like, several times on this show of going and rewatching things that you watched when you were younger and you feel like you enjoyed it or whatever, or you thought, wow, that was super funny, and you go back and watch it again and you were like, what was I thinking? I mean, is this how dumb all kids are? Are kids this stupid? And the answer is kind of yes, I think.
No, man, this is a really well done movie for little kids. Like, this is one of the most perfect little kid horror movies ever.
Oh, I wasn't talking about this movie in that sentence.
Oh, I see.
No, that was just the stuff in general. But no, this one, and going back, the first time that I had seen it in like forever was like last year when Disney Plus debuted and everything. They were like, okay, we've got this movie. And I'm like, man, I haven't seen this in probably close to 30 years. So I'm going to check it out. And it's hilarious.
Yeah, it's great, man. I don't mean to keep cutting you off. Keep going.
No. So let's go over the cast a little bit for people that.
Well, let me explain my.
Oh, okay.
So, because I'd never heard of it, I'd never seen it, but I definitely had never heard of it before. And so when I think you were talking to Bruce about it at some point, maybe off air, maybe on air, I don't remember. And I was kind of half listening because I didn't know what you were talking about. So I was in my own world doing something else. while you were talking about that. And so it didn't come across my purview until last week when we were trying to figure out what to do for Halloween. And I believe it's you who came up with Mr. Boogedy. And I was like, man, that's the perfect thing right there, because, you know, it's right in the wheelhouse that I like us to be in. It's something not everyone has just nitpicked to death, you know.
And it's the Halloween internet season.
Like it's own thing. And that is what I love. And so when you bring that up, I was like, great. Now this week comes around and now I have to watch this thing. And I'm thinking best case scenario is that this thing is going to be charming. Right. Mm-hmm. Because that's really what Disney kind of excels at. You know, back when I was doing my little experiment with dog movies that feature dogs, mm-hmm. Disney nailed it with that, because there's so many bad dog movies out there. And the Air Buddy movies definitely are one of those movies, but they are also charming. They're bad, but charming.
Yeah.
And so I was really hoping for that with Mr. Boogedy, and I knew that it was Disney because we're going to see it on Disney Plus. So I was like, oh, okay. So there's a real high probability that this is going to be something that, that at least is competently made. And man, what a joy this movie is. It is so unbelievably charming, this movie. And it's kind of fun. The dad with the pranks and stuff, that part isn't, you know, like after a while, you're like, okay, yeah, we get it.
That's the biggest thing in this, is to realize very quickly that this is a family of buttheads. They're all just terrible. They're all terrible. Like Christy Swanson's character is like the most level-headed one. Everyone responds with her like, yeah, I'd get tired if this was my family rather quickly. And it's not just like, you know, because in so many of these things, dad's just the bumbling, goofy, stupid guy. But the thing is like, and it kind of endears you to her at the same time. Mom is really into it, too. She's like, she loves and hates these stupid things that they're all doing. But at the end of the day, they're all just a bunch of dorks. So you kind of like them as a family just because they're like, they all deserve each other, really.
Yeah, they do. And the thing that I didn't put together is that because it's Disney, all of the actors on the show are going to be someone that you know from something else.
Yes, big time.
Like here, and it's kind of amazing, actually. Like even people who aren't main characters in the movie, you're like, oh, I know that person. Oh, I know that person. Oh, I know them. Where do I know them from? Like that keeps happening throughout the entire thing. But get into the cast list here, because we should break it down like person by person, really.
So is the dad, the patriarch of the family here, Richard Mauser, who probably people, you know, I put this movie and The Thing up as his two best pieces of work.
No way, man. I mean, yes. The Thing is one of my favorite movies of all time. I wouldn't put Mr. Boogedy as his finest.
Oh, you're right. Bruce would put in License to Drive. So you are correct as far as that.
He's also great in Risky Business.
That's true. But he's one of those great character actors, man.
Yeah, and you just know him because you know his face. And, you know, he was in everything in the 80s and 90s. And he's just one of those guys where you're like, oh, hey, that guy played dad for like 20 years on TV shows. And he's terrific, in this, because he really has to do the yeoman's work in this thing, where you have to believe to a certain extent that this guy keeps thinking that these are all pranks because he's a real prankster in real life, or the character is a real prankster in real life. So like anytime something happens, like, oh, hey, wow, that's a hilarious bit. You know, like the footprints up the wall. He's like, look, I can sell these at my gag store.
Which I also love how he's moving his family to New England so he can have the only joke stop that's there. And it's just any like stupid novelty item that you could think of, from, you know, vomit to whoopee cushions, joy buzzers, all of that crap. He sells that crap and that is his living. And he goes, I'm bringing my franchise to a place that doesn't have one, because by God, every area needs themselves, you know, a gag shop.
Well, you know, I'm sure Amazon has crushed that man.
You can buy chattering teeth from them for pennies on the dollar. Oh, God, I can't live.
You could buy a bushel of chattering teeth on Amazon for the price of what my
wholesale prices, boy.
My brain just literally blew up.
Yeah, because you dreamt of a life where you were selling chattering teeth for a living, and you decided, let me out now, please.
I don't know if you remember this or not, but there used to be three different magic stores in the city of Charlotte.
Holy crap, really?
Yes. When I first moved to Charlotte in 1994, there were three different magic shops, and I couldn't believe it. How many magic stores do you think are in Charlotte now?
If there's one, there's too many.
There is not. There is zero.
Because I can't imagine. But
I guess you could count Morris Costumes as a magic shop because they have a bit of magic stuff in there. But they have 1,000 other things in there, too.
I think magic shops need to, like kind of join forces with those like kind of crazy bizarre sort of things like you have in Gremlins, where you just kind of walk down and it's a whole bunch of just weird crap, and there would be like magic tricks amongst all of that weird crap. That's what I think.
I'm so glad that you just brought up Gremlins, because Gremlins is the movie that ruined a bunch of kids.
Oh yeah.
I was just old enough to see that movie and not be destroyed by everything that was happening in that movie. However, my youngest daughter, when she insisted on seeing Gremlins, got to the part where they're in the kitchen. That's literally where she was done. She's just done.
Yep.
And it took her years to get over being so afraid of movies like that. And that is the thing with Mr. Boogedy, is that Mr. Boogedy doesn't reach Gremlins levels. And so you can have like a 6-year-old watch that movie and they're going to be scared. For sure they're going to be scared in moments, but they're not going to be absolutely destroyed for years on end about it.
No, I was never traumatized from it. For me, it was just like, oh, that's scary. I don't want to watch that because it's scary. But it wasn't something like, I mean, because these are some of the kids, right? At the school, they would like talk about like, you know, Nightmare on Elm Street and stuff. And like just the even thought of that, you know, would send me in terrors, much less actually, you know, watching the thing. So this is of that level that, you know, your kid can be scared of it. But like you said, you're not going to get scarred for life off of this bad boy.
Right. And that's kind of the tightrope that they have to walk with this. And they do it great. You know, it's fun. I wouldn't call it funny. I never laughed, but it's fun. And it has a little bit of heart, like everything with Disney does. And I could see people who are massive horror fans seeing Mr. Boogedy now and being like, this is ridiculous. But you know what, dude? It's not for you.
Yeah, and I think the right kind of horror fan will actually enjoy this movie.
Oh, you do? Why do you think that?
Well, okay, because there's two types of horror fans I've kind of come to find out. They're the ones that can watch stuff like this and enjoy it for what it is. And there's another hardcore group that's usually probably a little bit bigger than that that just goes, no, that's stupid, that's kiddie, that's dumb. Because I've always said, like, horror fans are the most accepting and the most shunning people at the exact same time. They love everything that they love, but the stuff that they hate, boy, do they hate it, and they will let you know about it, you know?
It's true. Although I will say that I had always lumped in horror fans with you know, like all the other type of nerds there are. And that's not true, because every like massive horror guy that I know, like the ones who are like super, super into it, all of those people dress weird, mm-hmm. but are like just like the nicest human beings in the world.
They tend to be. That's what I've found in life, is that a lot of the horror fans, they may look a little bit odd to some folk, but they tend to be fairly decent people, by and large. That's what I found, at least.
Yeah, and for the most part, you know, like there's a little bit of social ineptness with them, like just a little
bit.
But
yeah, I think they
kind of
that.
Like that.
Yeah, I mean,
because I have a bit of that too, as do you, as does Bruce.
Yeah,
And so seeing, like, and I had never put this together until you just said it. I'd never put it together before that if I was going to hang out with a type of nerd, it would be the horror nerd before any other nerd.
Because like a lot of like comic books and other nerds, they've got like thoughts and opinions, and they've got like a lot of them have very encyclopedic knowledges of a lot of stuff.
It's true, but also they like new ideas because, mm-hmm. you know, those are the horror movies that work the best is when something new happens.
Mm-hmm.
And most horror fans are super accepting of that. Whereas, you know, let's take Star Wars for a second here, and I'm not going to get totally into it. But, you know, there are the Star Wars people. Star Wars fans are never going to agree on anything ever again, ever.
No.
It's just never going to happen. But with horror fans, there are people who are like, this is the thing that is great, and here is the thing that is great, and they are great.
Mm-hmm.
And that, and there's no fighting. You know, maybe there's a little bit of nitpicky of like, well, I think that Freddy is better than Mike Myers because blah, blah, blah. But for the most part, the things that are great are the things that are great, and that's it.
Yeah, but there's all great new discussions with, you know, kind of like newer horror directors like Ari Aster and stuff like that. Some people going, oh, this guy's a genius. Other people going, oh, he's a hack. And right. Yeah, there's fun stuff like that. So it takes all kinds. But let's go on a little bit of the cast here. Mimi Kennedy, who is in every television show you've probably ever seen in your entire life.
That's funny, man, because I know her as the lady from Pump Up the Volume.
I haven't seen Pump Up the Volume in like 20 years. I can barely remember.
I don't know if it holds up. I don't want to see it because I don't want it ruined for me, because when I saw that movie at the perfect age and it changed my life forever. I probably would not be on this podcast if it weren't for Pump Up the Volume.
Hey, not too bad. Christian Slater, give us a call.
Now it's really easy to have a bootleg radio show, but not back then.
Yeah, now all you need is a couple of bucks and ta-da.
That's right.
Any jokers can come up with whatever they want for however long they want. As long as they keep paying the bill, it's just fine. Patreon.com/agentp.
A movie about illegal radio.
Thrilling, says the New York Times.
Man, that was just the complete epitome of cool at the time for me. I was like, there's nobody cooler than Christian Slater. That girl is the prettiest girl I've ever seen. Like, you know, it's just over and over again.
Then the oldest child, we got Christy Swanson, who, come on, everybody. Come on.
I was never, her charms never worked on me.
Okay.
But, I mean, you know my type.
Yeah, I do. I do.
And now I'm really glad for that, knowing what a nut job she has turned into as a middle-aged lady.
I don't know nothing about that.
You are in luck.
Okay, good. She was one of those where I'm like, where's she been? What's she doing? I don't know.
Being nuts.
Hey, you got to go nuts at some point in Hollywood, I would imagine, to some degree.
And I got to tell you, like, the two boys, Faustino, David Faustino from Married with Children,
mm-hmm.
and Benji Gregory, who plays the little brother, those two are great as the brothers.
They are so good.
They feel like they're brothers.
That was very much kind of the relationship between me and my brother. That's about the age gap. That's about, you know, where we were when we initially watched this thing. So it's
were
about
you constantly complaining about your bear?
No. Well, that would have been my brother, but he was a blanket guy. He loved his blankie. Loved it. And would not sleep without his blankie. It took far longer to get rid of that thing than one would have imagined. But hey, you know.
Well,
that's what you get for not listening to this show, buddy. All right, so I can say whatever I want because they're not listening. They don't care.
Adam's going to torch you every week now, Adam's brother.
You're going down. But they're great. Honestly, the kid acting throughout this entire thing is really great. You go, that's how these kids would act.
Yeah, and you know, Faustino, because he, after a while on Married with Children, I would say after like like the second or third year on that show, he just kind of starts making the same facial expressions that Ed O'Neill does on that show.
Yeah, it's all the somebody just farted like a, face.
Yes. Whereas before that, you know, he's just kind of a cute kid. And so I found him very, very charming. He's a very charming little actor in this movie. And he's a very fancy little boy. And I like, you know, I like how they react to each other. And I like that they feel like brothers. They really do.
Yeah, just kind of, you know, hitting each other and just, you know, just little jabs back and forth and stuff. It's like, oh, it feels like they were definitely like you two hang out on set and stuff and become buddies.
It does feel like that. And it probably didn't hurt that, you know, like you got the teacher on set, like, you know, they have to go to class every 10 minutes and stuff.
Yeah.
That didn't hurt at all.
Then we got John Astin as Neil Witherspoon, the old guy who shows up in their house with a giant top hat on and his crazy eyebrows and talks about how this house is haunted.
He is so perfect for this movie. You cannot cast anyone better. He is so pitch perfect. Like, if you get someone who's scarier, like, it's too scary and it won't work for little kids. Mm-hmm. And if you get somebody who's goofier than him, it's just not going to work. He is literally the line. And they found him and he agreed to do it and we're all richer for it.
Yeah, as a kid, I definitely found him scary. It was like, you know, because he does all the ominous voices and he looks weird. He's got all this, you know, this crazy facial hair and the eyebrows and everything. He looks deranged.
Yeah, he does. He does a bit, yes.
And yet they were still this is the great part about like the 80s where eventually the kids are like, hey, let's go down to the Chamber of Commerce to check out and ask about why our house is haunted. And sure enough, the crazy old coot that was in your house before, who just showed up, you come into your house and he's standing, you know, in your vestibule going like, welcome everyone. And you're like, oh my God, this is insane. That guy's in the welcome center. And of course he has a story about how the plot of land where your house was on was haunted. And he opens up this giant old textbook and it's a pop-up book. It's a 100-year-old ancient pop-up book.
How big a town is Lucifer Falls?
First of all, you're moving to Lucifer Falls. Tip number one, don't move to a place with Lucifer anywhere close to the title. We're in the devil's butthole. Why? Who thought this town would be bad? Ridiculous. You
know, I know that they keep saying New England, but they don't say the state.
It's the area.
I'm going to guess what is in their head, what was in the writers' heads and the people at Disney is Massachusetts. Mm-hmm. Although Massachusetts looks nothing like that town.
It looks nothing like that back lot.
That's what they were saying because of the pilgrims and everything else.
Yeah, because we come to find out that there is an old pilgrim's tale, which, by the way, when we open this pop-up book, then we realize that they clearly ran out of budget.
Well, there's a couple of things that tell you that, right? Like when you're seeing the pilgrims and, you know, there's clearly like a theater backdrop behind them.
They're like, listen, the high school kids just put on Miracle Worker. We have their backgrounds. If we can just shove those back here.
Look, you make the jokes, but it works because the whole thing is just so dang charming.
There's fog on the ground, so you don't have to see what
that's right. The
like
fog budget on this movie is enormous.
It's gigantic. They're like, we got the kind where you have to mix in the two parts. It's the expensive one, so it stays on the floor longer.
Every time there's an exterior in this movie, which isn't often, but when it does happen, there's just a thick layer of fog on the ground.
The kids will know it's spooky if there's fog.
It's very, but it totally works. It totally works, man. And you know, they do the smart thing where they keep shooting light at the fog so that it feels like you're in a different spot every time they do it. But it's not. It's the same set.
Yeah.
And it's fine. It totally, totally works.
Chuck it over to the right there, Tommy. Change that light up a little bit. Boom. We're in another scene, babies.
Now it's all green.
It's the magic of movies over at Disney. They're like, we've got all the budget in the world. Guys, I got some bad news. That budget has been slashed. And we have to get creative. because there at least there are some special effects when, you know, Mr. Boogedy comes about finally in the third act. It takes a while to get there, but we eventually do get there. But oh, I want to talk about, so the idea for everybody, just to give you a kind of a thing if you haven't seen it. Mr. Boogedy was this old pilgrim guy who liked scaring children by screaming Boogedy at them for whatever reason. Kids left. He fell in love.
For whatever reason.
Because he was a jerk, all right?
Yeah, he's a massive jerk pilgrim guy.
So he falls in love with this. Was it Maid Marian? I feel like I keep wanting to say that.
The widow.
Widow Marian. That's. I knew there was an adjunct there.
And who can blame him? Because that lady is fine.
Yes.
Even through the pilgrim getup, you can tell she is a very attractive lady.
Even through the pilgrim speak, which is also, I'll throw in a couple of these and thys for good measure.
It's like watching Thor.
She's just like, pilgrims, old timey. Oh, thine has doth. Oh, Jesus, what is this?
There's a whole lot of doths.
He doth think I'd be crazy. And you're like, yes, indeed you are. But she's like, this is the best gambit ever. I don't understand where Mr. Boogedy gets this idea from. I've fallen in love with this lady. She will not have me, so I shall kidnap her child, keep said child away until she agrees to marry me, but yet I will still continue to keep this child locked up in this house forever.
And there's the most important part, which is I am willing to make a deal with the devil so that he can hand me a cloak that will turn me invisible, and that will make this lady love me finally.
Yeah, exactly. That was another one. In order to do the kidnapping and everything, he needs to get a cloak, which is where we're going to turn a little bit of a corner. And I will tell you right now, I think this movie, I think there's a lawsuit that needs to be, you know, brought to fore.
You're talking about Harry Potter.
No, I'm talking about Lord of the Rings.
Oh, wow.
Because this is Lord of the Rings territory right here, where we get there's some magic cloak there. It is very like Mordor. At the end, they've got to, like, you know, destroy it and make it go away. It's very Lord of the Rings. There's Harry Potter, no doubt, just because of invisibility cloak and everything. But I think it's almost more Lord of the Rings than it is anything else.
Well, look, they clearly know their audience. They know that we love magic cloaks.
Yeah, and the cloak, like, kind of made him old and insane and everything and all super decrepit. So, like, he very Gollum-esque. I'm just saying, it's kind of cool.
It is pretty great, man. And I like his look. I think that he looks great.
That makeup is, like, you know, 5-6 years old. That's some frightening stuff. And they do some close-ups on that face. And he's growling and sneering and stuff. And if you're a little kid, that'll get you.
You know, clearly they had the cloak and the face. Like, that was their two big.
Yeah, it doesn't feel like they thought the rest of the costume out super well.
No, it really doesn't. And it kind of shows when he gets his cloak taken away from him. But for the time when he's wearing the cloak and he's got the face, and it really is pretty great. And it's such a cool look.
And you got all, like, the neat, like, you know, green outline on him and everything. Mm-hmm. And you buy all the little powers that he has. I like, you know, what seems like a fun comical thing now, but him shocking the family and then their hair going on ends and stuff and falling backwards. It's like, now it's a joke, but when you're a kid, it was like, oh my God. Mm-hmm. It was, what does this guy have the power to do? And I love this kid and his idea, which is like, here's where the largest leap of logic goes in this entire movie. Is they're going after Mr. Boogedy because they finally realize, after a visit from a friendly ghost, we forgot to mention that.
Right.
The friendly widow ghost comes
in. The very good-looking widow.
She goes, my son doth tell me that whatever, he's locked in there. And that little kid who's, like, stealing the stuffed bear from the youngest member of the family, that kid's walking around in there. Yeah, he's stealing the kid from Alf is the youngest brother. But the other kid that's in there, the little the pilgrim boy.
Kid, the ghost pilgrim kid.
He has that I'm sure has to be dubbed because it's in that widow kid voice where they just will we do everything just a widow like this?
Well, as much as we are praising David Faustino and the kid from Elf, is how much I am going to damn the kid who's the pilgrim.
It's not ghost. Good.
He's awful.
Not at all. Like
he almost took me out of the movie.
Even like in the flashback, because he's in the flashback initially, and he says something, but you like it's like three or four words that come out of his mouth, and you're like, oh no,
yeah,
he's this is bad,
terrible. That kid, and you know everybody else is so pitch perfectly cast. It makes me think that either he is a producer's kid, or he's one of those kids that they're like. You know, if we give him enough reps, he'll be fine. Kind of like the Olsen twins, right?
All right. So let me, because I wanted to do a quick little search here. He hasn't been in anything since 1994, that kid. Mm-hmm. But apparently has 16 credits. He was on Webster.
Sure.
If that tells you anything, which makes sense.
You know, we talk about Webster way too much on this show for my liking. But when I was a small child... My version of Mr. Boogedy was the Halloween episode of Webster, and it scared the crap out of me when I was a little kid.
Oh, I feel like I've probably repressed that, but that almost sounds familiar. Is there like somebody had a devil costume maybe?
Maybe there's a rocking chair and there's a spooky house, and it was not great for
me. Oh, you watched The Changeling. That's different. No. Very different show. But listen, the movie is so silly, but I love, so the whole goal is to get this cloak away, and that will take away Mr. Boogedy's powers, and right. Then little kid can go join his mom, and they'll go back to ghost heaven or whatever. I don't know how these things work. But all of a sudden, this prop vacuum cleaner that Dad had shown earlier in the show... That doesn't exactly vacuum up stuff so much as a clown pops out of it and, you know, apparently is great. I don't know how that's a fun trick, but really only can be done once.
There's a couple of times where it's like, you know, Dad, you're not being funny. You're being a prick.
But just to make that, just to make what he did with the clown thing popping out of the vacuum. That's got to cost $100+. Are you telling me that you're going to take that and sell that at a gag shop and some fool is going to buy it for, let's say, easily $150 just so you can make a little bit of profit on it?
I just expect when he says stuff like, oh, this will kill at the gag shop, I just take his word for it. He clearly knows the industry better than me.
Oh, that truck that they're driving with all the like cartoons, it's so, wow, it's bad.
Oh man, you know what we forgot to talk about with the mom is that she has that really great laugh.
The Horseshack laugh.
Oh, it's so great that like because when at first I was like, "Oh, that poor woman." Like and then I started thinking like, "Why would that woman ever marry that man?" And then once you get to know the family a little more, you're like, "Oh, she's just as annoying as he is, just in a different way."
Yeah, it's like, "Oh, they're all kind of perfect for each other." I mean, except for Christy Swanson, she wants to get out of there like nobody's tomorrow, and who could blame her?
Right. She peaked too early because now she's nuts.
You look at the rest of the family.
Back then, she might be fine now.
That's what happens when you're in the Boogedy family. You get to you go a little bit on the nuts side. Have you heard from David Faustino in 20 years? I'm just saying.
He does work an awful lot, though. Like, because I looked up his filmography today because I was like, you know, look, I wasn't the biggest fan of his when he was on Married with Children, but I mean, you got to give it to him. He does keep working.
Kid works.
That part is great.
No doubt about that. Well, there's also no doubt that every single movie ever created, or at least ones that we'll review on this show for that matter, can be related back one-to-one with, believe it or not, Sylvester Stallone.
That's right, Adam, and Mr. Boogedy is no exception.
Ooh.
I have a prepared statement. LeVar Emmert was the prop master on Mr. Boogedy. He started his career in 1973 working on a movie called Dillinger, starring Warren Oates. And I didn't know it existed, but now I know that I want to see it. LeVar Emmert would work on many projects, like the movie Loverboy, a movie that if you had Showtime in the 90s, you definitely saw, because it was on literally all the time. I Want Pizza with Anchovies, Please. He also was the prop master on Baywatch, And what I say next may surprise some people to hear, but I've never seen a single minute of Baywatch, which I'm sure makes me sound like a liar. But I really haven't. Is it a murder mystery show? How much lifeguarding is actually done? Is it done with a wink and a nod? I don't have any idea, and I'll never know because I just don't care. But LeVar Emery's greatest contribution to society happened in 1992 when he worked on a little movie we've never talked about on this show before, and that movie's name is Stop or My Mom Will Shoot. Ooh. We have finally got there, everybody. Stop or My Mom Will Shoot. It's a movie that people make fun of a lot, as they should, because it's wretched, but not many people speak to the fact that Ving Rhames is in that movie. Ving Rhames is in Stop or My Mom Will Shoot.
Huh.
2 years before he was anally raped in Pulp Fiction, I'm guessing he's far more embarrassed by being in Stop or My Mom Will Shoot. Sylvester Stallone considers Stop or My Mom Will Shoot the worst film he's ever done. And there's a story about this movie that Stallone himself tells. I don't know if it's true or not, but the story goes like this. Arnold Schwarzenegger starts a rumor that made its way around Hollywood that Schwarzenegger wanted the movie Stop or My Mom Will Shoot for himself and that he was going to do whatever he could to star in it. Stallone hears the rumor, and since at the time they had a bit of an adversarial relationship, Stallone dropped everything he was doing and agreed to do it, thinking he was stealing a movie away from Arnold. Stallone makes the movie, and Arnold tells him later that he set him up with those rumors so Stallone would try to swoop in and take the project, which he did. And now Stallone hates this movie more than any other movie he's ever done. The guy who made Rocky V thinks Stop or My Mom Will Shoot is the worst movie he's ever made. I'm not sure who hoodwinked LeVar Emmer into taking the job, but I'm glad he did, because he's your Stallone connection this week. Adam, this is the 328th episode of this bit, and still no word from Sylvester Stallone.
Let him know about it, people. Congratulations, man. Between you and Bruce, pulling it out, man. These were tough ones, but...
Was fairly easy. This was a fairly easy one this week.
I certainly wouldn't have thought it.
No, me neither. I thought it was going to be rough. I started early on the looking around.
Looking on the outside, you're just like, maybe David Faustino was in a... No, probably not.
That is where I started.
You never know, because there's some moments of Stallone where you're just like, wait a minute, that happened? I don't remember that, because there was a couple of those years that were just really under the radar, just going straight to video kind of stuff that you don't even remember being a thing. And then it's like, oh, all right, fair enough.
Yeah, the bullet to the head years.
Yeah, very confusing. But here at Hear Movie Podcast, we have our own patented Robin rating system. If you'd like to check that out, hey, why don't you join our subreddit, man? We put up their memes and we'll talk back and forth to you, because that's what we do. We're interactive like that. And that's at reddit.com/r/HearMoviePodcast. Check it out today, everybody.
Please do.
So let's get into it. I'll start just because this is the one that was kind of on my tip here as something that I watched as a kid. It scared the ever-living crap out of me. Today, as an adult who watches a ton of horror things, I still can appreciate, you know, what it does and, you know, who it's meant for. And if you go in with this, you know, knowing that it's for people in the age of 5 to 10 years old, you're going to be okay with it, you know? It's not terrible, and like you don't feel like you've wasted your time at the end of it. And even if you did, it was only 45 minutes. And here's the cool part: if you dig on that, there's The Bride of Boogedy later, so you can get like a whole another feature film follow up to this thing. So,
there's a lot of people missing in the sequel, right?
Yeah, I mean, people get famous and just decide, okay, well, I got to go now. Peace. Thanks for boosting my career. Now I'm on to bigger and better things instead of the wild world of Disney or whatever this thing was.
Right.
So for me, I'm going to go Tim Drake on this one. Just fun, just out and out, just silly little stupid stuff. I love how he's, dad is just the worst. He's like such a dork. He sees, like, you've just come across like, you know, phenomenon from another dimension, a ghostly dimension and everything, and your first thought is, I can sell this stuff. Oh, this is great. You're an insane person at that point. You're just nuts, but there's something endearing about it.
The thing that I love about it is that the guy who plays the dad is in The Thing 5 years earlier, and he certainly looks the same as he did in The Thing, but those are two vastly different people. You know what I mean?
Yeah, one is on the edge of a knife going, am I infected with this alien creature?
He is so great in The Thing. He's so very, very good in that movie. And he's good in this, too, for what he has to do.
But I will say this, Wilford Brimley, most underrated actor in The Thing, because it's just like, man, oh, man, he's so good in that movie. And everybody
he's
got to
carry
Wilford
the entire
Brimley.
Couch by himself.
So basically, good.
So for me, this is also a Tim Drake. I did not expect to like this as much as I did. If you have figured out, you know, why it's great, what makes it great, then by all means you should watch it, especially if you have kids who are kind of interested in that kind of thing, like smaller kids. They will be very interested in Mr. Boogedy. You should totally, totally watch that with your kids. There's also a bunch of stuff that when I was looking up trivia for this movie that we never got around to talking about. Mm-hmm. Like the fact that this movie originally, the screenplay was a screenplay for a Cheech and Chong movie.
That would be amazing.
They had to retrofit because Disney ended up buying the script and they had to get rid of all the Cheech Marin stuff. Which is just so crazy to me, but it's true. That's where the
But think about came. It. Think about him saying, "Oh, the Boogedy Man," or like that would be great.
It does sound like something Cheech Marin would say for sure. Also, Joaquin Phoenix was up for the part that eventually went to David Faustino.
Huh.
Which makes me ponder the question, what would David Faustino's Joker look like?
It's tiny.
He would be very short. Indeed.
He'd be was there a shrinkometer? Is there a DC guy that shrinks people? Get Bruce on the horn. We need to figure this out. Shrinkadink Joker, played by David Faustino. But I also like the idea that we had there's a timeline where their careers switched and Joaquin Phoenix was on Married with Children.
I think it's somewhere around Gladiator.
And just like that, I give that a thumbs down.
And there's one other thing that we never really brought up, which is how weird the kids' names are in the movie.
Yeah.
Like you have Corian and you have Ari. Why those names? It seems very specific. I don't know what those are in reference to. I'm wondering if they're in reference to like some of the horror greats, you know, like makeup guys or something. I don't know.
I wish I knew. I mean, if there was a kid named Dick Smith, I would go like, yes, that's a makeup guy. Like outside of stuff like that, it's like, here's my son, Stan Winston. That I get.
But both of those people that you just name checked, even like an idiot like me knows who those guys are.
So that's outside of those. I'm not 100% sure, but perhaps someone might have an answer for us. HearMoviePodcast@gmail.com. And that'll do it, everybody. Thanks for sending us that comic book connection there, Bruce. We really appreciate
that. Awesome, Bruce.
We'd like to thank all of you. Now, quick reminder before we go here. Obviously, the requisite plugs, patreon.com/HMP. But for those of you that are supporters over at Patreon, we're having something special this month. I want to get people in the kind of voting mood. But only voting for things that matter, like our choice for what you guys are gonna, what we're gonna watch next week. But we're doing it differently than we've ever done it before. Get this,
what?
Sean.
This is news to me.
This is new. We're doing it on the Zoom call this time, though. If you are a part of the Patreon, part of the Zoom, and you are there on Tuesday night at 8 p.m., that is on the 20th. Tuesday the 20th, 8 p.m. Eastern, whatever time that is, look it up on your own stuff. I'm American. We do our own stuff. and I'm not good at counting. So what we're going to do is get everybody together. And if you want to, you can bring your own submission to what we're going to watch for next week.
Oh, that's great.
And what we're going to do is we're going to have you guys pitch it out, and then everybody's going to vote. And obviously, you won't be able to vote for yourself. I'll go over all the rules as we do it. But we're going to pitch the shows, and we're going to vote on them that night. We're going to do
I sure wish that I could join.
We're going to do it all live. So, and you get to come to the court. You get to make your case and say, hey, here's what I want to do. And by the way, there will obviously be extra points for, if you want to theme it kind of in the spooky holiday tradition, that will kind of get you a little bit more points on there. But we'll cover all of that as we go on. But that was kind of my idea. Number one, make sure that we can easily stream it and stuff so the three of us don't have to go scrounging and searching for all that kind of, nonsense. And if you want to keep it, Halloween or spooky themed or whatever,
it should totally be Halloween.
So throw that in there as well. Keep it in your mind. And on Tuesday, come on in if you're a Patreon supporter. And again, you can always do that, patreon.com/HMP at any level. And just come pitch your stuff, and we're going to vote on them, and then we'll review those movies next week. So there is that. Enjoy yourselves, my friends. But Sean, if they need more stuff out there, if they're looking for more entertainment, where on earth would they go?
The Mandalorian 30 Questions, which season 2 starts in 2 weeks. Is that right?
2 weeks. Yeah, we are getting there, man.
Yowza. Can't wait.
So super excited about that. So check out Mandalorian 30 Questions, Snowpiercer 30 Questions, and all the other fine stuff that we've got out there, man. We really appreciate that. And we really appreciate all of you fine folks. So join us next week when we're talking our Patreon select for the absent Bruce Leslie, Sean Kovacs. My name is Adam Porges. Stay super, everybody.
Bye, Marty and Evie.
Anything is what she is. Anywhere is where she's from. Anything is what she'll be. Anything.